Welcome to the Reviews Without Remorse podcast with Joe and Dave. Be warned, the discussions in this podcast will contain detailed spoilers. For spoiler-free reviews of newly released films, please check out our channel, Reviews Without Remorse, on YouTube and VidMe. Enter at your own risk and enjoy the show.
And welcome to the most awoken podcast in the galaxy. I am your humble Jedi Master, David. And coming out of the Millennium Falcon, your favorite roguish smuggler, Joe!
What's up, guys?
This is episode 43, and in this show, we will discuss... No, we'll get to that. In this show, we will discuss Star Trek Tarantino is going to be R-rated? Klingon, motherfucker, do you speak it? Everyone, their fathers, brothers, sisters, and cousins are swearing the Fox-Disney deal is done. So, why aren't the bride and groom talking yet? Jurassic World, Fallen Kingdom has a trailer. Will we discuss? Hell yeah, we will! From Japan comes a new animated movie, Batman Ninja, and the trailer dropped this week. The second trailer for Ready Player One has hit. It's stuffed with video game Easter eggs, so you know I'm excited. Alita, Battle Angel, has been a James Cameron's wish list for about 20 years now, and the first trailer just dropped. And lastly, strap yourselves in. We're heading into hyperspace to review Star Wars The Force Awakens. And how are you today, sir?
I am good, my friend. How are you doing?
Not bad. We have a lot to discuss.
We certainly do. Let's jump on in.
What does Marcellus Wallace look like?
What?
What country are you from?
What?
What ain't no country I ever heard of? They speak
Klingon.
Then what?
What?
Klingon.
Mother do you speak it?
Yes.
Then you know what I'm saying.
Yes.
So, Klingon, do you speak it? I'm kind of just a little... I don't know what to make of this. The idea of Tarantino doing a Star Trek movie in and of itself is interesting, but now we're talking about it's going to be rated R?
Yeah. I tell you what, let me jump in and say, Dave was reluctant to talk about this because we literally just covered this. But honestly, when I heard that he actually really was going for an R rating, I was like, okay, no. Now we have to talk about it because this is where the rubber hits the road. And honestly, I'm going to go on a record here and say, I got concerns. I have concerns. And honestly, you know, there's a part of me, like, the angel on one shoulder says, have faith in Tarantino. He can let him do his thing and he can handle it. And okay. But the other guy on the other shoulder is saying, hey, remember when Zack Snyder did this movie called The Watchmen? And it was great, and you thought this guy could, now that you've seen him do the negative side of superheroes, you could trust him to handle the positive side of superheroes, right? And then we realized we should not have had so much faith. Well, I don't know. Tarantino doing Star Trek, again, something that started out as a TV show. You know, forget about something that started out as a film series that might have been PG or PG-13. This was a TV show and did not require... anything resembling, I mean, an R rating to me says, look, I mean, it's one of three things. You're going to have excessive profanity, excessive nudity, or excessive violence. Do any of those fit Star Trek? I don't think so. And I'm just going to go on record as to say I'm concerned about it.
I guess it depends upon the subject matter that he's doing. Like, somebody suggested, hey, what if he did a Star Trek movie that's like the story of Harry Mudd? And I'm like, you know what? I can see that. That could be interesting. Or what if he does a Star Trek that talks about the history of Section 31? There's another area that could be explored easily in a mature angle, but still, you're right. The idea of an R rating just doesn't work.
I don't see why you would ever go that way. I honestly don't. It doesn't make any sense.
No. Not that I don't have a problem with boobs in Star Trek, because, you know... To me, that's like the best of all worlds.
Look, if somebody wanted to do a James Bond film as R-rated, it would make sense in a lot of respects. I'd have a problem with it. Mm. And Star Trek, I really don't see why you'd have to do Star Trek as rated R. I mean, I'm sure he has. I'm going to give him the benefit of the doubt and say he must have something very specific in mind. Apparently, he's written something and they're gonna pitch it and discuss it. So maybe there's a good reason, and maybe rolling the dice and seeing what happens. Maybe it's worth. I don't know. To take something like Star Trek and to do that with it, it's nothing makes me feel real positive about that.
I'm just going to say that, and one of the reasons I didn't want to talk about it is we're so early in this. We really have no idea exactly what's going on, what's happening,
sure.
or what he has in mind. He hasn't even talked about, there hasn't even been talk about, you know, okay, the script is ready, we're actually getting ready to film. I feel like once we get close to that, we have a better indication as to what to expect. Right now,
yeah,
it's just way too early.
But at that point, it's too late. At that point, it's too late to voice concerns. And like I said, I'm not saying that Tarantino is listening to our humble podcast going, oh, Joe's got a problem with it, let me change gears. However, in general, I think the conversation is worth having at this point because, like I said, if we wait and see what's going to get filmed, well, it's probably too late.
I don't see it being R-rated. I think they're floating that right now to gauge people's reactions. I don't see it being R-rated. There's no way. You can't do that. That would be kind of a franchise killer. I mean, think of it this way. Like, the closest we've gotten to an R-rated Star Trek so far is arguably Discovery. And that's a shit show. It's as simple as that.
Right.
So
exactly.
I don't think we need to go darker. I think we need to go, you know, it's like Tarantino needs to, like, watch The Orville and just be like, okay, this is kind of more what I need to go for. Maybe he should direct an episode of two of Orville to get his to get his beak wet or something, you know?
Maybe, yeah. Right, and frankly, that's a fine example, because, again, look at Star Trek Discovery, and they try to make it edgier and threw a couple more F-bombs and curses and things in there, and did it help? No, not in the least.
Nope, not at all.
If anything, I felt like it just exacerbated how little they know about Star Trek. So I don't know. Listen, Quentin, nobody loves you more than me.
Let's give it time. Let's give it time. Let's have faith. If the man wants to do Star Trek, the guy knows Star Trek's limitations. So he's got it. He understood like the Kung Fu movie exactly when he did the Kill Bill movies. So we just got to hold out. We got to be patient.
Yeah.
We got to hold out. We got to hope.
Let's keep hope alive. Okay.
So, an article came out last week that said that the deal between Disney and Fox was pretty much a done deal. And every single news organization has picked it up, saying pretty much the same thing. Only Fox and Disney hasn't said anything yet. What the hell? I figured by this point we'd be talking and like throwing confetti in the air, being like, woohoo, welcome back, Dr. Doom, and all that stuff.
Yeah. Well, I guess it's too early to call. I mean, it does seem like it seems like it's full speed ahead. It does seem like it moved quickly, and it does seem like it's happening. So I am anxious and excited, but yeah, I guess we just gotta wait for that. We gotta wait to pop the cork, I guess.
It's taking too damn long at this point. Now I'm growing impatient.
Yeah. I would really love some good news. I kind of feel like I'm ready. I'm ready to hear the big news that we got Fantastic Four and Doctor Doom and the X-Men. Oh my God. Ryan Reynolds had a funny tweet last week.
I don't remember exactly what he said, but I know exactly what you mean. Talking about him and Mickey Mouse.
Yeah, something about like the sexual tension between Mickey and Marvel or something or other.
good stuff. Yeah. Well, you know, I don't. Next time we talk about this, let's make sure it's because this is it. It's done. It's a done deal, and We're finally going to get a decent Fantastic Four movie. Or at least one can hope.
Let's hope.
So, what are you dating, like an accountant now? Or...
Owen.
Ventriloquist?
Stop it.
You love a dummy.
This is not why we're here. You can blame me.
Try to shame me. I know why we're here. A rescue op. Save the dinosaurs from an island that's about to explode. What could go wrong?
Blue is alive. You raised her.
So, confession time. I was just on Jurassic World.
I'm with you. The only thing I really sort of noticed was, wow, the effects are really looking spectacular. Not much they can't do these days, but we sort of know that already. Yeah, I'm wondering what's left to do with this franchise, frankly. I feel like, you know, when it first came out, it was mind-blowing. But unless you're going to give me something more than just people on the island with the dinosaurs, running from dinosaurs... it's running the risk of sort of slipping into Transformer territory. Like we've seen it, we've done it. Okay.
It kind of is. I mean, the whole idea, even the idea from what the trailers explain, I mean, okay, you got Jeff Goldblum back. Hello, Ian Malcolm. Nice to have you back.
Caught that. Yeah.
But the whole idea is we're going to try to save the dinosaurs because the volcano is about to erupt on the island. That's your plot? That's the reason you're going back to Jurassic World?
Yeah. It kind of doesn't exactly jive, does it?
No, I felt really nothing when I watched this trailer. I really did. I was kind of like, I'm going to have to see it because my kid's going to want to see it. But I feel nothing. The only thing it may have going for it is it's being directed by J.A. Bayona. He's from Spain, so please forgive me for completely murdering his name. He directed a movie called The Impossible, which was about the tsunami with Ewan McGregor. That wasn't that bad. He also directed recently a movie called A Monster Calls. So he's got some chops, but I don't necessarily know if this is going to be like the movie that does the crossover for him.
I don't know. We'll see. I didn't even see the last one in the theater, and I'll see this one in the theater only because we got it on the schedule. But honestly, that to me is it's a red box. I'm not dying to see these anymore. It's just okay. It's more fun running from dinosaurs. Fine, but and that's what the trailer is. The trailer is them running from the dinosaurs, running from the ash and volcano, I suppose, and the. But it looks pretty familiar. On the other hand,
holy moly, was that amazing or what?
Wow. Holy cow, did that look good. And it's funny because I guess it was last week we talked about the Batman by the Gaslight trailer, and we thought that looked interesting.
Yeah.
But wow, does this one look pretty wild?
Oh yeah! It's a first time director. He's actually directed a lot of video game titles. This is his first big feature. And oh, I'm sorry, ladies and gentlemen, we're talking about the up and coming Batman Ninja, which is a complete Japanimation story of Batman as if he was a ninja in feudal Japan.
And the animation on this thing looks amazing.
Outstanding.
Like, I've never seen anime. I mean, and it still has that anime look. Like you'd almost swear that they're blending somehow computer animation with hand-drawn anime.
In the right way.
Like, it's really, really interesting looking.
Oh, God. The design is really nice. The way Batman looks in his ninja/samurai outfit, just oh God, with the big yellow bat and the black and the giant shoulder pads and the sword. He just looks so badass.
And the Joker looks amazing. And
he looks, oh my God, I'm so looking forward to that fight. I am so looking forward to that fight. That fight's going to be a freaking amazing.
Yeah, I really hope this thing pans out and turns into something interesting.
It's being released in Japan sometime in 2018. There is going to be an English language version. I don't know. I may see the subtitled version personally.
I might also. That's yeah. I mean with the cartoon you got to figure it, especially these DC they do a damn good job with their animation, so I have faith that whatever they do, if they do an English dubbed trailer, it won't be like a typical, you know, like watching Godzilla dubbed.
Yeah.
But no, I mean, I think they should do a good job either way. So I would easily watch both.
I agree. It looks, oh God, so outstanding. So outstanding.
My name's Wade Watts. My dad picked that name because it sounded like a superhero's alter ego, like Peter Parker or Bruce Banner. But he died when I was a kid. My mom too. And I ended up here. Sitting here in my tiny corner of nowhere. There's nowhere left to go. Nowhere. Except the Oasis. A whole virtual universe.
So, I get the feeling that you're not as excited about this movie as I am.
I think you are right, but your excitement is infectious. I have a feeling there's more that you know than I know.
Ready Player One is a novel written by Ernest Cline. I've read it like twice now. It really is. It's a love letter to the early days of video gaming, to the 80s. It's a whole love letter to that time frame. And the basic gist is you have this billionaire, goodness, what's it, recluse. Like a Howard Hughes type, but this Howard Hughes type was a video game guy. When he dies, he decides he's going to give his fortune to whoever can find an Easter egg that he has hidden inside his most popular video game, The Oasis. And this is the story of the person, the people who are trying to find it.
Oh, and that would explain the, didn't I hear some Charlie and the Chocolate Factory music? The first trailer especially?
Exactly. I have, okay. Actually, Spielberg, when he was in pre-production for this, originally he wanted, he wanted Gene Wilder to play, why can't I remember his name? Jesus Christ, I just read the book. Halliday.
Okay.
Is the guy's name. James Halliday. He wanted him to play the part. And then he died, so I don't know if he was ever actually going to play the part. So, and it, actually, if you listen in throughout the trailer, right at the end, what's the last couple of notes you hear? A little Back to the Future. Ding.
Okay.
You know, because the character that, the main character's name is Wade Watts. His avatar's name is Parsifal. And Parsifal drives a DeLorean that he won in game. There's a level in the game that you can play like Back to the Future, and if you complete it, you get the DeLorean.
Oh, okay, very cool.
Right, so that's
I call it the DeLorean, obviously. I didn't know the story with it. Okay.
Oh yeah, and that's the whole thing about it. It's basically a world that's a giant MMO, but you know, it's become like the biggest commerce in the world. People basically escape there all the time. It's. Mm-hmm. And it's a bit of a dystopian future, as you can tell, but the book was really good. It was really enjoyable. It was such a love letter to people like me. And this movie trailer is looking outstanding to me. And I was piecing through scene by scene, just looking for like little things like, oh, look, there's Commander Shepard from Mass Effect. Oh, look, there's Tracer from Overwatch. Oh, look, there's Chun-Li from Street Fighter. You know, oh, look, there's Deathstroke and Harley Quinn. You know, different avatars with different people. It was freaking... Ah, just outstanding.
Okay.
This
has definitely got Dave written all over it. I totally admit, but yeah, I'll give it a shot because it looks. I mean, it looks like a damn good movie. So I'll just say
it's a Spielberg movie, and sure. it's funny too because there's a lot of Spielberg references in the novel, which Spielberg has basically said I'm dropping all those. The only one I'm not dropping is the DeLorean because that's his car.
Right, right, okay.
And the music's being done by Alan Silvestri, so we'll get a lot of interesting Back to the Future-esque musical notes throughout the soundtrack. It's looking good. It's very much like the novel. There's a couple of slight changes that they made. I'm okay with that. The big villains are this conglomerate ISP. They're trying to win so that they can monetize the Oasis. You know, the whole typical, you know, yay, good guys and, you know, all that stuff. It's the story itself is simple, but it told well. It could be a fun adventure.
Well, look at you.
May your dreams bring you peace in the darkness. May you always.
This is just a body. It's not bad or good. That part's up to you.
Alita Battle Angel. So, this is a 30-year-old manga that James Cameron's been trying to make for like 20 years now, and he gets Robert Rodriguez to direct the film version. This is the trailer that we just saw.
Yeah, I tell you what, this one looks interesting. I can see why it would be popular. I saw some interesting things about it, but I'm saying to myself, is it 20 years too late? Because I feel like at this stage of the game, we're getting overloaded with these kinds of stories, like I'm half robot, half real, half replicant, half this, you know.
Yeah, we just had that with frickin' Ghost in the Shell with Scarlett Johansson.
Exactly, right. And Ghost in the Shell should have done a lot better, but I think, like I said, it's based on something that had been done 20 years ago, had already been mined to death, so by the time they did a live-action version of it, everybody's seen it already. So now we're going to do this one, which is looks like the same exact storyline, and I don't know. It's kind of getting to be too much, I think.
I'll be honest with you. I like the look of it. I like the kinetic nature of it, because Rodriguez is very good with that, so I had no doubt about that.
Yeah.
But I kind of agree with you. I think we're too late. I showed it to Heather, and she was like, "Heh." It's just been done to death, and it couldn't have come at a worse time, as far as I'm concerned. We're in the death knell of the when you have, like, to me right now, the definitive robot philosophical view of robots, I think Westworld, and it does it so damn well that nothing else that comes out now just feels cheap in comparison.
Yeah, Westworld, Blade Runner.
Mm-hmm.
Ex Machina is not so long ago.
Oh my god, Michelle, like Ex Machina was amazing.
Yeah, I mean we're kind of getting to where, like, okay, we get it. I mean that's getting to be the hot button, you know, storyline for movies now, and it's like, okay, I get it, but I don't know. It's like I said, it kind of like Jurassic Park, Jurassic World. It's like, all right, you're gonna have to do something. You're really gonna have to pull a rabbit out of the hat to show me something I haven't seen real recently. You know, I mean, I like the look of the film because I thought it was interesting that they made the girl look like an overly perfected, like the eyes are a little too big and she almost looks like an anime kind of, you know. Okay, I mean, I'm with you, but I don't know, it could just be another one for another rental.
Who are you?
I'm no one.
I was raised to do one thing. But I've got nothing to fight for.
3 decades after the Empire's defeat, a new threat arises in the militant First Order. Stormtrooper defector Finn and spare parts scavenger Rey are caught up in the Resistance search for the missing Luke Skywalker. Written by Lawrence Kasdan, J.J. Abrams, and Michael Arndt, based on characters created by George Lucas, directed by J.J. Abrams, Star Wars: The Force Awakens.
Oh, Bionic Man?
Oh, I remember.
I loved Bionic Man.
Remember Chewbacca again?
Oh, I love to remember Chewbacca.
I remember.
Yeah. All right, who's going first?
Okay, so having rewatched this, it is still visually quite pretty. It's very well visually directed. And every shot is almost like a moving painting, which is something I expect from a Star Wars movie. The plot at the beginning is good. Okay, it's a retelling of A New Hope. Let's just get that out of the way. It's a retelling of A New Hope. That's fine. You know, if they want to do that as a means of bookending the two stories, fine. Whatever. I was on board with the story right up to the moment they hit Starkiller Planet. And even before that, I was starting to, like, waver a little bit because the whole conceit of it's like, oh, look, they built another Death Star. Yay. Can we not have the threat be a Death Star, for God's sake? Again? No. This is a planet. It's bigger than the Death Star. They even make a point of pointing that out, that it's bigger than a Death Star. I didn't have a problem with a lot of the movie. I don't hate the movie. I just want to come right out and say I don't hate the movie. But I felt like they played it almost too safe in order to try to bring the fans back after what is arguably the debacle that was the prequel trilogies. And in a way, it suffered because of it. That's just my initial impressions.
I will jump on what you just said and agree wholeheartedly that I think that what you got here is they're so gun-shy after the prequels that I swear the mandate had to have been make everyone forget about the prequels and get us excited about Star Wars again. And I genuinely feel like I think I made the joke once before, this should be Episode 7, not the prequels. That could be the title of this film.
Star Wars, not the prequels.
it definitely succeeds at that. They definitely do. They bring, I mean, I'll start off with a whole bunch of positives. They bring life back into Star Wars. Mm-hmm. It's not that, you know, room full of stoic people just talking. And they know how to do interpersonal relationships again.
Yes.
There's energy. There's excitement. They do that. They do that well. They give us characters that are easily likable. I saw one comment about when Finn and Poe first meet and they make their escape and they're talking as they're shooting and somebody said in 30 seconds they were able to convince me that these two guys are friends better than 6 hours worth of prequels to convince me that Anakin and Obi-Wan are remotely friendly.
Right.
So they definitely succeed at that.
Yeah, and I thought they've succeeded that with all the new characters. I felt for the character of Rey. I felt for the character of Finn. I felt for the character of Poe Dameron. I was quite okay. It's like, okay, if these are our proxies going forward, I'm okay with that. They're good, strong characters. Mm-hmm. I have one issue with Rey, but we'll get to that. But on a whole, that's fine.
I have one issue with Rey too, but it is a ginormous issue, which covers a lot of ground, but we'll get there. I'll tell you what, that, I mean, like you said, it's a good looking film. Mm-hmm. It was certainly exciting to see, like, even things like the dogfights with the X-Wings and the TIE fighters, the way it would happen sort of over the water and the X-Wings were kicking up the water behind it. It was great to see that, you know, our classic Star Wars dogfight done in a more realistic, you know, modern way of showing us this, that you really get a sense that you're there and watching it happen.
Exactly.
So having said that, I tell you what, if we had started this podcast a year earlier, okay, this probably would have been a case where I saw it and walked out all excited and loved it and would have come out and given it high marks.
Oh, hi, Mark.
Given it high scores. And Then a couple months later, come back and revisited it and said, you know what? I was wrong. I don't like it as much as I did. Because when I first saw it, I was totally on board. I mean, I saw the failings and the things that we are going to discuss. But at the time, you walked out and your adrenaline was so high that you were sort of willing to forgive it because the actor, you know, the people were good. It was so good to revisit and see people you haven't seen in so many years. And Star Wars was back. Mm-hmm. You know, Star Wars was back and it was exciting.
Right.
Then you sit and you think about it and you realize what you just saw. And like you said, it's, first of all, the fact that they just basically retold Star Wars, I find so baffling. That to me goes up, that's Batman versus Superman territory level of baffling. Like, why would you do that? You can't, because again, like, now it's done. It's canon. It's episode 7. It's done and we can never go back and do it again. Mm-hmm. Why would you go back and literally, I mean almost beat for beat the whole thing to just redo that story again does not make any sense. And that's that, even just the laziness aside, I don't understand how you went from Jedi where they defeated the Empire, okay? And you fast forward a couple of years and we're back to the same exact spot where the Empire, excuse me, the New Order
first
runs
order.
Everything, the First Order, and the Rebellion, excuse me, the Resistance is now the underdogs again. I'm saying, how is that possible? Why would that be? That makes no sense. And of course, like you said, they build a Death Star, which is a trillion times more. I've said it before, the science in this film sort of goes out the window.
Oh yeah.
And that was a thing that you never really had to struggle with in the original, even the prequels, for crying out loud. Well, maybe I'm being generous. But I mean,
let's not bang on the prequels. Let's focus on this.
Well,
we will bang the prequels another time.
Fine. I felt like in the earlier films, you were never really struggling with the science of a lot of this.
Mm-hmm.
But here you're watching this thing, how you can build a Death Star inside an existing planet, and then you have it. Oh, it sucks up the energy by devouring a sun. And you're saying to yourself, okay, so wouldn't the temperature be rapidly dropping every minute this is happening? Because you're depleting the sun, right? And when the sun is gone, you should be a block of ice, right?
Yeah, pretty much.
Well, apparently not. So already we're, so basically the fact that they're retelling episode 4 again, A, it's just pure laziness, and like you said, it's the safe bet. Just tell that first story again and we're bound to, you know, have people happy. But it doesn't make any sense why the situation would be as dire as it is. And frankly, I don't like what they did with our characters that we know. I mean, we're reintroduced to the characters that we were raised on, that we love, and they were the picture of heroism, okay? And everyone did things for the right reasons. Even Han Solo, who starts off at a rogue, who shot first, by the way.
Yes, he did.
You know, he rises to the occasion and becomes a fighter with the good guys and all this stuff. And now we come and revisit them years later. Han and Leia, not only are they separated, they dumped each other, both ran back to their perspective, what they used to do before, because they had a son, and not only is he a jerk, but they basically had the next Darth Vader. And apparently Luke ran from his responsibilities and went and hid as well. So now not only are you starting off on the wrong foot by giving us this story that doesn't work, you've also gone back and ruined our favorite characters.
I can't disagree with you. You're 100% correct. There are plot threads in this movie that they take for granted that kind of are big plot threads. Okay. Yes. Okay. Fine. The Empire, just because the Emperor was destroyed did not mean that the Empire was completely destroyed. There were probably a bunch of ships out there that could easily explain the First Order, but you still need to explain the First Order. You know, this is the remnant of the old Empire. Okay. Fine. How did that happen? Can you tell us a little bit about that? But nope, can't tell you that. Okay. Luke has run away from his responsibility after Kylo Ren destroys the Jedi Temple. Well, okay. I mean, that's mostly inferred. That's not even, like, come out and said that's exactly what happened. But you're pretty much inferred. So Luke decides to just, you know, F this, I'm out. Leia and Han, you know what? Leia and Han not working out doesn't bother me so much. That doesn't bother me that much. The two of them are too gosh darn bullheaded to really have a good long-term relationship. Theirs was a moment of fire more than anything else. She's too damn stubborn and headstrong. He's too much of a frickin' flighty little, you know, hey, whatever, and everything like that. That never was going to work out. I didn't have a problem with that. And, you know, they still even had the attraction there. That was fine. I didn't have a problem with that. But I still feel like all these other things, these little hints and allegations, like, there's so many times throughout this thing where it's like, ah, you know, here comes a key thing that's going to explain a bit of a problem. Nope, we're saving that for another movie. Okay, Han and Leia. So, you know, things didn't work out. Maybe if you read a comic book, you could find that out. It's like this movie is set up for doing the rest of the larger Star Wars universe. It's annoying. Yeah. I mean, I can, you know, seeing it, this is now my third time. Seeing it my third time, I've been able to at least infer in my head how things occurred, and I'm kind of okay with it, but it's not the way you should do a movie. This isn't something you're supposed to infer. There needs to be a clear line. When we first met these characters, there was a clear line as to exactly who these were and so on and so forth. You didn't need to know the story of what the Empire was, regardless of what the prequel trilogies will try to tell you. You didn't need to know that. You just knew, these are the bad guys, these are the good guys, good, go. But now you're talking about a movie that takes place after their biggest victory, and there's no explanation as to how they went from here to there. They shoot that damn planet. They shoot their first thing, and they destroy those five planets to the point that they specifically go down to one of the planets, and this girl comes rushing forward to see the red thing coming forward, and you think to yourself, there's a cutscene. There's no way you focus on this particular actress when they're destroying that planet unless there was something significant about her. There's a scene that they cut that might have been able to explain a little bit the deal with the Resistance and the deal with the First Order. But no, you had to just keep moving forward and, you know.
I agree. And it's funny, as you're talking, it's funny that for a film that is essentially retelling A New Hope, which is frankly one of the most perfectly structured films in history. A New Hope works. The structure of that film is so perfectly crafted. The fact that they're going to retell it here, yet it's so clunky that you still don't know what the hell is happening, that says something. You know what I'm saying?
That Star Wars was lightning in a bottle.
I mean, you're right. It's lightning in a bottle, and you're right. Just going back and trying to retell that story does not guarantee anything. You still have to give us correct setup and let us know who is who and what is what and why. Right. And I completely agree with you, by the way, that I don't have a problem with the idea. I mean, put it this way. When I heard way back in the 80s, like, I remember the 80s, I always heard this is going to be a 9-part story, that there's going to be 3 trilogies, right? It's going to be 4, 5, and 6, and then 1, 2, and 3, then 7, 8, and 9. That's what I always heard. So when Lucas finishes his, you know, the prequels and decided, you know, that's it, I'm taking my ball and going home, you knew that there were supposed to be 3 more. My interpretation was always that there was going to be some sort of a resurgence of the Empire. Something was going to emerge in its place. Because frankly, I never quite understood why you blew up the Death Star in the first film doesn't mean the Empire is dead by any stretch, but when you blow it up in the third film, that means the Empire's dead. So I never quite made peace with that myself. So I really don't mind the idea that there's going to be a new threat here. But it was supposed to be a new threat here, not a threat that has already taken shape and seems to have had a foothold for many, many years now. Where you have a whole entire empire which with a bigger Death Star and more people and et cetera, et cetera. Why is the rebellion back as the underdogs again? It does not make sense. And frankly, why are they the resistance now? If you still got Princess Leia standing next to Admiral Akbar and Nimnub and all these other, like, the same people are still there. So why are they now the just call them the Rebellion, then, if they're still the Rebellion.
Oh, God, dude. I don't know. You know, we should start by breaking down some characters since we're on the topic.
Bring it on.
All right, so Finn. I don't have a problem with Finn. I like the idea of Finn. I like the idea that we're past the clone trooper stage, that they're just regular people, and this is a guy trying to get away from that. I'm okay with that. I don't have a problem with him. I don't even have a problem with Poe Dameron, because they basically introduce him in the crawl. He's the best pilot. Okay, and like, I kind of liked his little exchange at the beginning of the movie with Kylo Ren. It's like, who's going to talk first? You talk first, I talk first. I'll talk first.
Now, you see, I just don't like that. I don't like that at all.
I like that. I was okay with that.
Frank, you know what? Because in Star Wars, they always had a very regal way of speaking. You know, they always spoke with a regal way. That's the only word I can think of. I mean, they always spoke very... You know, the Queen's English kind of thing. It was like even with an American accent, but the Queen's proper English. The fact that now we're going to get, like, we're going to appeal to this snarky, funny millennial, you know, Chandler Bing type joking around. I don't know. It's that stuck out to me. And again, I'm here for a Star Wars film, and that stuck out as being very different.
Now, they were trying to establish that he was the roguish type, and that's definitely a roguish type of characterization to do. So that's what that was. Now let's keep going. Next we have Captain Phasma. I don't know. She wears silver stormtrooper armor. That's about all I know about her. When the first time I saw her, I was like, ooh, that's cool looking armor. She's going to be awesome. She had 10 minutes of freaking screen time.
Yeah. She's the Boba Fett of this movie, because I think
not in a good way. Not in a good way.
They threw in for 10 minutes, and suddenly there were Captain Phasma dolls everywhere, and like, oh, she's gonna be great. Okay, fine, whatever.
Yeah, sure. Although, truth be told, I am kind of looking forward to her and Finn fighting in the sequel. Next, you got General Hux. You've got who's just basically your Tarkin, who manages to live to the end. You've got your Snoke, who's God knows what the hell he's supposed to be. And this goes back to the whole thing about dangling plot lines. Who the hell is this guy? How is it that he's got all these people together? Where the hell is the money coming from to finance the First Order if they're not in charge of the galaxy?
Right, exactly. There you go. And, you know, I don't mind some mysteries being left unresolved until the next film. I don't mind if they throw things in there that we don't understand just yet, but the whole plot seems to be structured on these sort of elements. So now we really don't know what's going on.
Yeah.
Like even hearing Princess Leia tell Han Solo, you know, we lost our son, and she goes, no, it was Snoke. Snoke seduced our son. And it's like, well, then, okay, well, now I got to know then. Well, you know, then who is he and why? Why would they do that? Why is a vanquished empire, why is one guy, I mean, at what point did he seduce the son? When they were just starting to come around and start the empire all over again? Was the empire established at this point?
Was he a family of friend that was hanging out? Was he a Jedi potential that was turned away? Who the hell knows?
Yeah, so, and it's, you know, and I guess they're going to, I mean, I remember when the movie came out and there was all these theories about who it could be. I hope some of them pan out, because, I mean, it could be interesting, but still, I don't know. I don't know. It still left this one. That's a big matzo ball to leave hanging in this film.
That's a giant matzo ball to leave hanging. And speaking of matzo balls, let's talk about Kylo Ren.
Wow.
You know what? Honestly, I don't blame the actor. I thought the actor did okay with what he was given. It's just, you know, emo Hot Topic Vader wannabe.
Yeah, that was a huge disappointment for me, because again, first of all, the motivation seems so strange. The motivation seems so weird.
They haven't even really established his motivation. He was being trained. Snoke turned him to the dark side, and he seems to be dancing between the light and the dark side.
Right, but I guess he embraces the dark side wholeheartedly by the end. To the point where I say, if they try to redeem this guy by the end of the series, no, forget it. We'll talk about that later. I won't fast forward, but. I wasn't crazy about that either. And even when they took the helmet off and you saw his face, I was like, oh, but Darth Vader didn't do that. Like, why would you? First of all, the design of the mask I thought was awful. You know, I'm saying to myself, we had Darth Vader, which is one of the greatest design character designs ever.
Yeah.
Where you know there were designers working on that look for a long time before they came up with Darth Vader. It was something that was like so iconic and so original at the time. This to me looks like this. They went down to the store where the mountain bike guys, the masks. They could have just pulled like a ski mask off of a shelf. It was very lackluster, I thought. I thought the voice thing was fine, but. I don't know. Like it didn't. It didn't do much for me. Again, he's a young kid, so that alone kind of kills it. It's like make the bad guy really bad. Don't make him like this kind of kid who you're whatever.
Well, obviously he's not the real bad guy. He's just the forward of the bad guy. Yeah. You can't really beat Ralph McCreary's. Designs for Darth Vader. You can't. It's an iconic face. You're not going to beat it. But I could see some, you know, Hot Topic wannabe trying to be his own little, you know, thing. But it's still not a compelling character. And then, you know, finally, Rey. thank you. There it is.
There's the only problem, but it's a far-reaching problem.
It is a tremendous, tremendous problem. Now, I'm going to start off by saying I have nothing against the actress. Nothing at all. She's a fine actress. I enjoyed her in Murder on the Orient Express recently. And for what she got, she did fine. But there's the problem is, like, they're telling this story about this character that is basically, it's going to make sense once the trilogy is over. It's like, it shouldn't have to make sense once the trilogy is over. It has to make sense in a movie that you're doing right now. There is no logic, that this, you know, I can see that as Kylo Ren is mind probing her, that she fights back and the beginning of the Force is awakening in her. I can see that. I'm fine with that. But then suddenly she can freaking get... Daniel Craig Stormtrooper to let her out of her bonds and walk out of the room and then pull a lightsaber away from Kylo Ren, which, by the way, that is the most ridiculous scene in the entire movie. Kylo Ren reaches out with his hand. I want that lightsaber. Oh, shoot, it's coming at me too fast. Whoa, and he moves out of the way? Yeah. That's the lightsaber you want.
Right.
What the hell?
Yeah. No, I totally agree with you, and frankly, I do have a problem with the actress, and it's not her personally. It's not that she did a bad job, but we've kind of alluded to the Disneyfication of Star Wars. I took one look at this girl, and I said, "It looks like one of the kids who grew up from Mary Poppins." Like I take one look at her, and I see Disney. That is the Disney character in this film, and. And again, I kind of don't like the British accent, frankly, because, you know, traditionally you had the American accents on the good guys and the British accents on the bad guys. What's that?
Maybe that's foreshadowing.
Yeah, I doubt it. I think it's chim chimney. She just seems so Disneyfied to me. I kind of can't stand it. And yeah, the fact that she's a Mary Sue. Now again, I'm not gonna get on a tangent about the diversification and the need for diversity in all the movies. Now, I mean it's obviously first and foremost on everybody's mind, and we have to have diversity. So the leads in all our Star Wars movies are all gonna be females, which that's fine. I kind of don't even mind that. But again, the problem is you want to have a woman, a capable woman as the lead. So you're so afraid to write her failings. You're so afraid to show her weaknesses. You have to. They now have to make her smarter than everybody. Everybody goes, wow, she really knows what she's doing, and she's real smart, and she's real capable. She can fly the ship that she's never flown before like a pro. She knows the ins and outs of the Millennium Falcon. Like, why would she know all this stuff? Better than Han Solo does. That makes no sense. She knows the Force. No one has seen anybody do the Jedi mind trick yet. She just knows to do it. So that's the problem is that you wrote this girl perfectly. So where's the arc? Where's the character arc? There is none. I mean, when she grabs a lightsaber at the end, it's just like, well, of course, because she can do everything else.
Oh, she can fix the Falcon. She can fire a blaster. Her first shot with a blaster is a kill. Her second, third, and fourth shot with a blaster is a kill.
Yeah, and she has been doing. I mean, it's I think it's been made pretty clear that she has been doing nothing since childhood than walking around the desert picking up scraps.
Yeah.
So I don't. Yeah, but now she just seems to know everything. Like she's this walking encyclopedia. So I thought that was silly. It didn't make any sense. And by the way, we touched on Finn's character. I'm not crazy about him because first of all, I like the idea of the defecting stormtrooper, and I thought that was a really good... I remember one of the comics when they did that. There was a Marvel comic when they had a stormtrooper who defected, and him and Princess Leia end up hanging out, and of course she keeps, you know, she's chiding him pretty good, you know, because he was a stormtrooper, and he's like, look, I quit, I didn't like it, or whatever, who knows. So I thought that was a good angle. But, again, I just thought they just dropped the ball on his character, because, again, he doesn't really... First of all, I just don't like that he's comedy relief. He's jokey, and it's like, all right, dial it back already. I mean, like, we get it. We get it. It's not the prequels. So he's jokey all the time, but then, like, he's... When you think about it, like, he says at the beginning, he tells her, oh, yeah, I'm with the Resistance. Well, why? What was the point of that? He lies and says he's in the Resistance. Then they go to the cantina scene, by the way, which we should talk about. And at that point he sort of says, you know what, this is not for me, screw this. And so he goes and finds somebody to take him out of there. And of course that doesn't go so well, but it's like, all right, I'm not really loving this character if he's gonna just sort of quit and run away and lie and everything. I'm not getting his motivation. So I mean, I understand that he just wants to get the hell away from the First Order, that makes sense. But, again, he's not really heroic. I mean, I guess he rises to the occasion. I mean, he goes to rescue Rey later. But, again, he does that based on a lie, too, by the way.
Yeah, so, he said, I can help you with the thing. Oh, no, I'm just kidding. I just want to save her.
Yeah, all right. So, and I almost feel like they're downplaying his character so we can prop Rey up as being the do-all, end-all of everything. So... Yeah, you feel it. You feel it as you're watching. You feel like that. You know, they're giving you other characters who are not as good, only so Rey can be so propped up. And like I said, I hope, you know, the new film is coming out this week. We're gonna see it. I'm hearing good things so far. I'm not watching any reviews. I'm avoiding any spoilers, but the buzz is good. So I'm hoping that they can take what they've started and take it in the right direction. And maybe this is just the foundation that we needed to create. But in this film, it's not really doing it for me.
Well, then let's talk about the cantina scene.
Seriously, you want to talk about beat for beat? When I went to the cantina, I was like, geez, really? We're really doing this. Okay. It wasn't so bad because, I mean, it wasn't like they didn't spend a lot of time panning around the room at all the kooky, you know, characters.
No, just a quick pan around.
I mean, it was quick and painless. But then here's Maz Kanata that everybody knows who we're meeting for the first time. Okay, now we got Girl Yoda.
Yeah, or something like that. She just happens to have Luke Skywalker's lightsaber just hanging out in the basement.
Yeah, and they even say, I thought it was interesting, they even say, like, he says, where did you get that? And she says, it's a good question for another time. Which basically means we're not going to cross that bridge now.
Yeah, that one slapped me across the face. That was like, you sons of bitches.
Right.
You know?
Yeah.
These are the stories we want to know.
Yeah. I heard that there was a cut scene where you saw the lightsaber floating through space at one point, and it was as if it was drifting towards that planet for some reason. Uh-huh. I don't know that that's true. I can't guarantee it or verify it, but yeah, it is a fascinating. I love the meme that I saw on. I probably saw it on Facebook. There was a meme where they show her handing the lightsaber back to Luke, and Luke is looking at her. And underneath it says, was there a hand? There was a hand with that. Did you get the hand? So, yeah, how that thing gets from Bespin to where it ends up, I would be very, I don't know.
It's not. Here's what it is. It's fun. It's not logical.
Yeah, right. Exactly. It is. Well, and let's talk about, you know, again, now Rey goes down. I guess the Force calls her to get to touch the lightsaber, and as soon as she does, she has all these weird flashes. Okay, all right. And there's a shot of Luke with the hand, and there's R2-D2, and I guess that's going to be explained in the next film. But again, as I'm watching this, I'm saying to myself, what am I watching here? I'm not getting it yet.
This goes back to what we said about, both Batman v Superman and Suicide Squad, in that, you know, the stories that they leave untold in both of those movies are much more interesting than the movie that they have here.
Yeah.
Because I want to know the story of the First Order. I think that's rather important. How does the scrap remains of the former Empire suddenly get enough people together on one planet, carve it down the middle, and make a weapon out of it? How does that happen?
Yeah. That doesn't make any sense. And incidentally, by the way, you know, I also can't remember the last time or what we were talking about where I was saying, you know, I guess we were talking about Thor Ragnarok, and I said, you know, they ditched all this stuff from the first two films, and I said, well, I guess I can't have my cake and eat it too. If I don't like the first two films, I guess I can't complain when they dismiss everything from the first two. Here again, I remember complaining about the prequels and that George Lucas now in his, you know, I'm not going to get into his politics, but he was so afraid to have people just be bad guys that you had, like, you would have these, that's why you had weird lines of dialogue like, well, from my point of view, the Jedi is evil.
You know, like, you're lost to me!
Right. From my point of view, the Jedi is evil. Everyone has their own point of view, so there's no good and bad. Everything is shades of gray. Okay. And I thought, as annoying as I found that, now the Empire is like Nazis. Now we're going full-blown evil, evil, evil bad guys to the point where they actually come off as Nazis. And right as you're about to jokingly start going, Sieg Heil, the arms go up like Nazis. Yep. And it's like, all right, jeez.
You made that clear. On the floor. I'm sticking your face into the poop.
Right? Yeah. We're slapping you across the face with this one.
oh, God. Terrible. No, not actually terrible. I'm kind of glad that they at least made it very clear that this isn't a Shades of Grey thing, that these guys suck. I'm glad with that. The only thing they really made Shades of Grey is, you know, Kylo Mopey. He's the only one that's like, I'm good, I'm bad, I'm good, I'm bad, I'm good, I'm bad. And it's happening again, because you can see it in the up-and-coming trailer, where he's like, you know, driving that hybrid of his grandfather's car and his dad's car. Because, you know, if you look at the back of his ship, it's got, like, the Millennium Falcon-type tail section, only it's in red. And he comes across Leia's ship, and he's like, shoot the bridge, and, you know, whatever the situation may be. And he's being all hesitant. He is like, please, can we stop? You know what? A part of me would be, I don't know how they can redeem him. If the long story is they're going to try to redeem him and Rey goes bad, I like the idea of that, but I don't think they did it in a way that makes the redemption something that I'm rooting for.
Exactly right. And we might as well talk about the other elephant in the room.
But then let's hit it.
If you're going to try to tell me, first of all, I hated that scene. I did not like the scene where Han Solo gets killed. Spoilers, by the way. that whole scene when Han Solo and Kylo Ren bump into each other on the bridge, and again, can they put some railings on these bridges, please? Like, there's no railing in all of Star Wars, I swear.
God darn it, Joe, you know there's no OSHA in space.
They meet and they have the conversation. He does the whole like, oh, I'm torn back and forth because of this and that and the other thing, and then he starts to hand things over to Han Solo. He takes the thing, and then he stabs him with the lightsaber. And I was like, oh no! First of all, I just hated. There was something about it where I thought like, Han Solo just kind of went out like a punk, like he didn't see that coming. Like, I don't know, and you couldn't have done anything about it. And then he kind of, like, touches his face right before he falls over, and I was like, oh, that's nice and everything, but I don't know. I didn't like it, and I said to myself, I said, look, if after that, if they try to get this kid to go over to the... No. You stay over there on the dark side, we're going to kill you. That's it. You're done. You killed Han Solo. So you're not coming back. You're not coming back to the good side. I don't care if Princess Leia sits there and begs, please bring him back. No, you can't come back. You ain't welcome.
I don't see how either. But I think that's where they're going to go.
I hope not. I would really be disappointed if that's what they do. I wouldn't be surprised, because I'm agreeing with you that I see some foreshadowing and I can see them trying that. But
no, they beat us over the head with the foreshadowing. It wasn't even subtle. Yeah.
Right. I mean, the fact that he's like a 20-something kid sort of makes it almost obvious that he can't be all bad. He's just a kid. So I hope they don't. I hope they don't bother, because I'm already struggling to stay with what's going on in these new Star Wars films.
Then we just have to hope that Rian Johnson can pull it off. It's gotten good reviews. I like the guy as a writer and director. I'm trying to be a little bit hopeful. I'm trying to be hopeful that, like, you know, like, you know what this is? This is like J.J. Abrams walked into a room and built the Lego set without following the directions, and then walked out and said, "Okay, Rian, it's on you." And here comes Rian in, and he's looking like, "Jesus." It's like, "Okay, but it's a Lego set. Maybe I can make this work." Let's kind of hope that the guy's got some skills.
That's actually a pretty good analogy. It does feel like a Lego set that they put together without following the directions.
Yep.
They had all the parts, and they didn't quite get them to gel right. I agree.
There are stories about what happened.
It's true. All of it.
So what's your rating? Out of 10.
Oh, wow. This might sound harsh. I'm going to give it a 3.
Ooh, God, that's harsh.
Yeah, I mean, it's a competent film. It is a competent film. It is a good-looking film. It does do what it sets out to do, which is to get away from the prequels, to reignite the love of Star Wars, to bring back certain elements and to bring just energy and life back into the series. But again, how you could possibly... You're doing episode 7 and all you do is redo episode 4 over again, and do it kind of in a poor man's fashion, where you get the poor man's Darth Vader and you got... I mean, I'm sort of baffled by it. I'm baffled by why you would do something so... And to do it in such an obvious way, too. I mean, it wasn't like you walked away and somebody like 6 months later go, "Hey, wait a second. These story points kind of seem a little familiar if you really look at it." No, it was blatantly over the... "Here, take the plans and go through the desert." And I mean, it was... I mean, you couldn't have done it more obvious. So, yeah, I kind of find that pretty unforgivable. And there's so many just... things that happened that were not logical, didn't make any sense. Story-wise, I don't think anything having to do with the story, the plot, very little of it makes any sense to me. Everything is... there was so much convenience and coincidence, and again, so little is explained that I have a hard time getting excited about anything story-related. So, you know what? It was good to look at. It was fun, but I expect more from a Star Wars film. I'm sorry. And, you know, I'll tell you what, the funny thing is, I think one of the solutions would have been probably the same thing I would have prescribed for the prequels, which would have been have George Lucas give you a story outline and then take that and hand it off to people who can do screenplays and everything else and just make it work. But take the elements of what the guy did. So, believe it or not, I'm a little annoyed that they completely dismissed George Lucas and just threw everything he did in the garbage, because I felt like you should have at least taken that as a general outline and then go back and fix everything that he does wrong, but make it work. And I think that's exactly what they should have done. But now we're just going to get a mishmashy, Disneyfied retelling and little more. So I have high hopes for the next one, but this one didn't do it for me.
Well, I wasn't quite as bad as you. I gave it a 5. Felt that there's that, regardless of its shortcomings, I still, watching it again, I still enjoyed myself. I did. And, you know, and yes, there are things that are glaring and there are things that kind of grate on me, but I liked watching it. I enjoyed how it looked. I enjoyed, you know, the sound. I enjoyed, you know, granted, my score is probably more based on member berries than true criticism. I admit that. I 100% admit that, but I did.
That's perfectly fair.
Yeah.
I mean, they're appealing to our sense of nostalgia, and there's a reason, and we enjoy that part of it. I don't mind saying that there was things that I saw that I was excited to see.
Yeah. So I keep it a 5 mostly because I still feel like, you know what, you do need to check this out. It's not a zeitgeist the way the first Star Wars that they aped it was, but it's still an important part. You know, if people ask me, should I watch the prequels, if I've never seen any Star Wars movies, should I watch the prequels? No, that's a whole other topic. But this is still continuing the story, so I'm going to just cut it down the middle and say, go ahead and see it.
Mm-hmm.
But keep your expectations in check.
Okay, that leaves us with the Who Asked You?
Oh, man, I had two, and as we've been talking, I've kind of mentioned them. I'm going to go with Enough with the Death Stars! Enough! Enough with the world-killing crap! 3 times! That's the 3rd time you've done a world-killing storyline as part of the main Star Wars! Stop it!
Agreed. Okay. Here's mine. Here's my Who Asked You, and we had not mentioned this yet. The part when Han Solo gets killed,
mm-hmm.
and they go back to the planet, and Princess Leia is standing there.
And I know what you're going to say.
And she walks right past Chewbacca to give Rey a hug? No. No, no, no. That's the part. Not only does this film not make sense, but I don't like what they're doing with our existing characters, how they come off. When that happened, I was giving the middle finger to the screen saying, no, she should be hugging Chewbacca. The two of them should be hugging and crying, for God's sakes. But he walks right past her like she's not even there. That killed me. I was like, no, I almost feel like that was the part where I'm like, movie, you lost me. You just gone and lost me.
Well, thank God they lost you in the last 2 minutes of the movie. But yeah, that was shit. That was some serious shit.
And
I was watching that too. Technically, Chewie walked away from her. Chewie was following Finn.
Either way, it's fine. I mean,
needed to be a scene where the two of them reminisced or something.
They should have hugged. The two people who loved Han Solo the most should have hugged. Not this new character who you're pushing on me to love. Again, you're already kind of annoyed. As the viewer, I'm already kind of annoyed because I get the idea that Rey is just so perfect and so wonderful. I get it. And you're pushing this character on me. All right. But then Princess Leia goes to hug her. Have they met yet? I don't even know if they've even met at that point.
Once.
Didn't she already get taken off the planet before Leia even showed up?
No. She was there at the conference and everything like that when they were deciding. No. Oh, wait. No. You know what? You are right.
She gets kidnapped off the planet right as the Resistance shows up and Leia gets off the...
They did not meet. They've never met. Oh,
so
shoot.
Why are they even hugging? I mean, again, I'm praying to God that there is some explanation coming up that they know each other somehow, some way, or the Force tells them that they know each other. I'm just hoping, okay? Because that is just unforgivable.
Wow.
The fact that they did not have Chewbacca and Princess Leia hug after Han Solo gets killed.
I completely missed that. I feel embarrassed. Wow.
You're probably confusing it with Rogue One, where she was in the conference meetings for other things.
I don't know. Maybe. Wow. Okay. All right. For your consideration.
I will just sort of I can't think of one thing in particular, but I will just sort of reiterate what I said before about it's the action and the personal relationships that they get right in this film. Mm-hmm. They knew enough to bounce back from the prequels with a sense of energy, with a sense of good action and interpersonal relationships with people who get along and like each other and dialogue that shows us that these people are friends.
Right.
Again, the prequels three prequels cannot convince me that Anakin Skywalker and Obi-Wan Kenobi are remotely friends. In this one, 30 seconds of Finn meeting Poe, and I already get it that they're friendly and they like each other.
Yep.
So, well done on that, in that respect.
For me, I was very glad that they used a great deal of practical visual effects, practical sets, and practical makeup effects.
Agreed.
I really, really thought that that was so nice that they did that. I was very happy to see that, actually.
I agree. And interestingly, it's funny, they do that for most of the film, and they left two major characters to be done completely as CGI, and it's noticeable.
Mm-hmm.
It's almost like, well, why did you do those two characters as CGI characters when everything else is practical and looks good?
I don't know, because they wanted a different actress to play Maz, I guess. I don't know what their deal was with that. I don't know what their deal was with, you know, oh, okay, the Starkiller base has been destroyed. Now's the time for R2-D2 to wake up.
That's another one. And again, I hear people going back and forth with that, trying to come up with an explanation. Why is he out cold just because Luke is not around, but yet he somehow knows to wake up at the right time to go find Luke? Doesn't make any sense. And it's funny, every time I hear people trying to come up with a possible solution, it doesn't really work.
No.
Like what if Luke called to R2-D2 to tell him to... Yeah, but R2-D2 doesn't have the Force. So he wouldn't really... That doesn't make any sense. Or the fact that he's on a timer. Like, I mean, again, he's I don't know. It just, nothing about that really made any sense. And again, I thought the whole idea that this whole thing hinges on finding Luke Skywalker, I thought was a little odd. Because again, you've already, I mean, they keep talking about Luke Skywalker like he's kind of the savior of, he can, the first line of the film is, this will begin to make things right. Like, finding Luke is going to fix everything. Luke was already running Jedi school, and Kylo Ren came along and destroyed the whole entire thing and ruined everything, and Luke went off into hiding. I don't think Luke is the savior of anything anymore. I don't think he's any... Why even the bad guys are looking for Luke Skywalker because they're afraid he's going to come back. You ran the guy off. He's done.
Yeah, why not just, you know, he took his ball and went home. So play on your own court. Jesus.
Seriously. I mean, again, you could not have ruined that character anymore, frankly. He took his ball and went home. If I'm the bad guy in this situation, I could care less where he is. Because obviously he's not a threat.
Well, Joe, that only leaves us with the hope that after this weekend, maybe this movie will make a little more sense.
Go ahead. I hope that that's true. And honestly, you know, again, like I said, I'm hearing good buzz, and I did see that the Rotten Tomato score is already pretty high.
But it was pretty high for Force Awakens too.
Yeah, that's true too. That's true. But
I fell for member berries. I fully admit I fell for member berries, and it's part of my enjoyment of it. I admit that. So it's still possible that this could be a case of member berries.
It can, yeah, it absolutely can. But I'll just say I got my fingers crossed that they can sort of pull it off. Because again, these are not dumb people. I mean, these are capable people who made this film. It's mm-hmm. it's the choices that they intentionally made that I find so baffling. But I'm hoping they can pull something off with this one. And let's also keep in mind, too, the director of The Last Jedi is also the guy who they've slated to do the new trilogy.
Right.
So they're obviously pretty happy with him. And this is a company who has no problem firing directors if he's not performing.
No, so, they seem to do it willy-nilly, don't they?
Yeah, every time I turn around, there's another director or directors getting fired. So... not only do they like this guy, but they've given him the keys to do a whole new trilogy, which I find kind of fascinating. So I'm hoping that's an indication that things are okay.
Well, we'll find out in a couple of days, because as we've been teasing, that's right, next week, Star Wars, The Last Jedi. Star Wars. The last, you are the confusing. Last Jedi.
It's another confusing title, too, by the way, but okay.
No, that's not true. They refer to Luke as the Last Jedi several times in this movie, so I guess it's not too confusing, unless a fact that basically when this is over with... You know what? There's another fun thing that could happen. What would happen if, like, just Rey went dark side and, you know, her and Kylo Ren went skipping off into the woods at the closing credits? That would be hysterical.
Yeah, I hope not. I really hope. I mean, again, I could see them at this point just throwing anything at the wall to see what sticks. But I hope they keep it together. Let's hope.
Well, and we will talk about that next week. So, hope you enjoyed this review, ladies and gentlemen. And everybody, have yourselves a great night. Joe, have a great night.
Sir, may the force be with you. I will see you next week.
Thanks for listening to the Reviews Without Remorse podcast with Joe and Dave. Join us here every Thursday for a new episode. And be sure to check out the Reviews Without Remorse channel on YouTube and VidMe for spoiler-free reviews of new releases, as well as in-depth discussions of current and classic cinema. If you enjoy this podcast, please consider becoming a patron. You can find our page at patreon.com. As little as $1 a month goes a long way. All clips in this podcast are used for commentary and critique, and is considered fair use. No copyright infringement is intended.